to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil he doth richly repay. Not a grief or a loss, not a frown or a cross, but he's blessed if we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Update our prayer list. We have Barbara Ditch, who's a member of the church family, who's feeling under the weather. And I received a message this morning that Rhonda Hutt, Monty's daughter, was in an automobile accident. She was flown to Fairfax Hospital. And so we want to remember Rhonda in our prayers as well. So please be aware of those additions to the prayer concerns that we have. You offer us mercy and grace and love. You offer this, the gift of life eternal. As we, your people, gather this morning, we come with hearts of joy and celebration. We thank you for the faithfulness and witness of Mrs. Ford as she gathers with us and pray your special blessing upon her. We thank you for the chance to gather together as your people, to hear the wonderful hymns and music, to celebrate one another, our lives, and our challenges. As we gather this morning, Lord, we offer special prayer for Barbara. We ask that you would be with Rhonda as she goes through her surgical procedures. And Lord, even in the midst of this difficult situation, we thank you for her presence in our midst, the blessings that you've poured out on her. We ask that you would continue to watch over Rhonda and the doctors as they bring healing through you. This morning we also lift up to you Dan as he's going through testing and ask that you would just surround him with your love, and we pray for favorable results of the tests and the procedures. We remember Jose and Gay and Bill and Marie. Lord, we ask that you would continue to be with Cheryl Ann and be with Lynn and Linda and Jeanette and Chuck. We pray for Duke this morning, remembering Bill as well. But even as we gather this morning, O Lord, there are those around us and of this church family that are struggling with anxiety and stress, pain, and the darkness of depression. We pray, O Lord, in the midst of the struggles that we are confronted, that we would find your comfort and your strength, that we would learn to trust in you in all our ways and not lean not on our own understanding. We pray for those who are struggling with decisions in life, the future, that you would guide us in making the right choices and the right decisions and moving forth in your spirit. We pray, O Lord, for those that are so confronted with financial issues, and we turn them over to you, O God, who is the source of everything that we own, every blessing we receive. Lord, we are in a time of great national turmoil. We don't know and don't understand all that's happening. But we know that you are a God who would proclaim a peace that would pass all understanding. You would call us to reconciliation and justice and love. And Lord, in the midst of all the turmoil and confusion, we pray for wisdom. That wisdom that you poured out upon Solomon, that we might move forward. We thank you this morning for this chance to be here. Lord, I thank you for all the saints that have made this possible for us to gather this morning. Those that have gone before us. Truly, we mourn their loss, but celebrate their life. Help us always to be mindful that you go with us wherever we go. And may we always be reminded to take time to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in the Spirit and one mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves. Not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of the others. In your relationship with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but not much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you to will and act in order to fulfill his good purpose. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Of men, follow me, follow me, follow me, follow me. At the end of myself, judgment calls out my name. I've been looking for love, but I'm swallowed by shame. Throw away all your stones, find forgiveness in me. Let me be your passion. My daughter, you're free. Follow me. Follow me. Follow me. I've done things my own way. This world gave up on me. Now it's death I do pay. You know who I am. I sin sacrifice. Today you will be in pain. Those who believe will live eternally. At the end of yourself, just follow me. If you lose everything, just follow me. I will give you new life, just follow me. Follow me. If at the end of yourself, just follow me. Lose everything, just follow me. I will give you new life, just follow me. Follow me.
Thank you very much, Michele. For those who are watching or will watch the service online, we want to encourage you to share your offerings. You can send them in or... there are through PayPal or other options that you may contribute. Your offerings are important for us to be able to continue to feed those who are hungry and reach out to our community. Would the ushers please receive the offering this morning? Jesus. Genesis. I'd like to share from is from the fourth chapter, beginning in the second verse. After Eve gave birth to his brother Abel, now Abel kept the flocks and Cain worked the soil. In the course of time, Cain brought some of the fruits of the soil as an offering to the Lord. And Abel also brought an offering, fat portions from some of the firstborn of his flock. And the Lord looked with favor on Abel and his offering. But on Cain and his offering, he did not look with favor. So Cain was very angry and his face was downcast. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry? Why is your face downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It is a desire to have you, but you must rule over it." Now Cain said to his brother Abel, "Let's go up to the field." And while they were in the field, Cain attacked his brother Abel and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Where is your brother Abel?" "I don't know," he replied. Am I my brother's keeper?" The Lord said, "What have you done? Listen, your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. Now you were under curse and driven from the ground which opened its mouth and received your brother's blood. When you work the ground, it will no longer yield crops for you. It will, and you will be a restless wanderer. Would you pray with me, please? Lord, I pray now that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart would be acceptable in your sight. And by the power of your Holy Spirit, you would speak to our hearts and to our lives. For I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I can remember back in the days when I was in school, occasionally someone would get out of order, or a couple people in class would become unruly. And the consequence of that was that our class would either have to give up our lunch playtime, or I remember one time in middle school or junior high school, that the entire class got detention, which meant we had to stay after school. You see, because of a few people, everybody, in a sense, suffered. This morning, I want to share with you that with God, it's going to be a little bit different. That God judges, God looks at each of us as individuals and judges us and sees who we are as people. Now, sometimes I hear people say, well, you know, I'm not as bad as so-and-so. Or, I don't do the things so-and-so is doing. You know, I can't jump up and down as fast as so-and-so or whomever. And we have a tendency to compare how we are to other people. I'm not as bad as, you know, John, because... Or, you know, I don't have a mouth like so-and-so, says all those nasty words. And somehow we think we're better because of who we compare ourselves with. And this morning I want to share with all of you, that's not going to be the case when we stand before the judgment seat of God. We are going to be evaluated by who we are, what's in our hearts. And how we have behaved, not according to everybody else. And I also want to remind us that each of us is different. Corinthians chapter 12 talks about the gifts that God gives. And not all of us have the same gifts. I suppose I shouldn't share this, but Pete was a great guy. I mean, he'd have given you the shirt off his back. And the church got pencil holders to put in the back of the pews. Like, I don't know, do you all have pencil holders in your pews? Well, we got some of those, and I said, you know, Pete's such a nice guy. We want to encourage him to be involved in the church. I said to the trustee chair, can he just let you help you put the shellac or lacquer or polyurethane on him? After the next week, the trustee chair pulled me aside and he says, please don't ever ask me to do that again. Pete can't paint. You all are blessed this morning. You had Cristina and Michele sing for you. Amen? You can't say that for me. I didn't sing for you and you'd be glad. Great way to clear the room. At my last church, we had church service at 11 o'clock. Services lasted about the same time as here. And they said I could sing any time after 1. You see, we have different gifts and abilities, and God is going to judge us individually about how we use the gifts and talents and abilities that we have individually. And this morning, God was blessing Cain and Abel. And they came before God to worship Him and give thanks for what God had blessed them in their lives. It says that Cain and Abel had different talents, different abilities. And they understood that in order to truly worship God, you had to bring or give of who you were to worship. And so this morning as we gather, I know some of you gather and offer your offerings electronically. We worship by bringing our gifts and offering them on the altar. We bring ourselves and our souls and bodies and mind and strength and gifts this morning to worship God. This morning, as we were reading, if you've read the story of Cain and Abel, you see, we read that Eve had two sons, and then later on, we read that they're bringing in a harvest. These are grown men now. They had been taught about who God was. They knew and understood it was important to worship Him and also to worship Him not only with words, but with a portion of what He blessed their lives with. So Adam and Eve had taught them, Cain and Abel, who God was and His power and majesty. If we go back and read in the early chapters before this, we just remind you that Adam and Eve got kicked out of the Garden of Eden. The only thing they got, the only thing they had when they left there was literally the clothes on their backs or the fig leaves they had. And so we're reading now that God had truly blessed Cain and Abel. They were now having flocks and they had tilled the soil and it had multiplied and blessed them and flourished. And Abel was a shepherd and he brought his sacrifice. Verse 4 says that Abel brought a gift, the best of the firstborn, the very best of the firstborn lamb from his flock. And God accepted Abel's gift and also accepted Abel. You see, when Abel went to worship God, he took the very best he had. First, prime, blue ribbon. But Cain, it was a different story. As we read the story, we need to be aware there was a difference in the quality of what they brought. I shared earlier, my granddaughter came, so I went and got peanuts so she could feed the squirrels. And there's a squirrel that comes and sits on the windowsill. I call him George, and I know it's George because, you see, George evidently had gotten in a fight or something, and the whole left side of his body, the fur is off, and it looks like he's got a scab or something on there. Well, the rest of the squirrels are, I don't know who they are, but George I know. You see, George would not have been an acceptable sacrifice for Abel to bring to the altar to worship God. That sheep had to be the firstborn, and it not only had to do that, it had to be perfect. Abel would have had to go and inspect each of the sheep and check them out and make sure there's nothing wrong. And that's what he brought as to worship God, the very best that he had, and the firstborn. That means that there may not be a secondborn or any descendants. He was offering the very best. You see him saying, well, this sheep doesn't quite qualify. There's something wrong with it. And God accepted Abel's offering. God knew that he brought the very best that he had. And he honored God with giving him the best. Abel gave from his heart, from deep inside of him, truly worshiping God. And God found it acceptable and honored Abel. But there was a difference between the two brothers. You see, Cain also brought an offering. And he bought whatever he could scrape together. It didn't matter. He wasn't choosy. It was just to kind of do it. And God wasn't pleased with Cain's offering. He wasn't pleased at all. And we have to understand that God judged each of them separately, just as God judges us as individuals. But you see, Cain became jealous at his brother because God found acceptable what Abel had done and was not pleased with what Cain had done. And so Cain plotted. He says to her brother, let's go out to the field and let's talk. And it was there in the field that Cain, one scripture says, fell upon his brother. He killed his brother. And we have then in scripture the very first murder that occurs in the Bible. And God comes to Cain and asks him, where is your brother Abel? And Cain's response is too reflective of too many. I don't know. Am I my brother's keeper? Can you see? Can you hear the lie? Him justifying his action, trying to satisfy himself and excuse his behavior. He's suggesting that his brother Abel is not his responsibility. I just have enough to take care of myself. There aren't anybody here, I'm sure, who bear the guilt of killing another person. But I do have to wonder how many times we have sat by and watched idly as people die spiritually, die from a lack of understanding of who God is, and because of His love for us, that He gave Jesus Christ as a sacrifice for us, His firstborn. We sometimes forget that the world is literally going to hell in a handbasket, and we ask if we are our brother's keeper. Is it really my responsibility? Am I my brother's keeper? We have to be mindful that Cain's response was insincere, dishonest, and defensive. Cain knew what he did and had done. His hands were still bloody from what he had done to his brother. He had no excuse. He couldn't offer a temporary loss of memory or whatever. He was guilty and he knew it. But you see, God really wants us to live together in peace and harmony, and to make it possible for us to come together and worship Him. But you see, Cain, who used to say, I'll do it my way? Frank, thank you. Frank Sinatra. Cain says, I want to do it my way. I want to worship God the way I want to do it. I want to be convenient. I don't want to have to offer the first fruits. I don't want to have to go to all the efforts. Now, some have become confused at the fact that God only wanted animal sacrifices, but that's clearly not the case, because in Leviticus chapter 2, he says, when you bring a grain offering, God was acceptive of the first fruits of the ground. He says, when you bring the grain offering to the Lord, may it be of the finest flour. The finest flour. You see, what Cain brought was not the finest. He brought it with an attitude of indifference. He wasn't concerned about how he offered his gift. Genesis 4:3 says, when the time for the harvest came, Cain presented some of his crops as a Cain gift to the Lord. Cain didn't go out and find the very best fruits and vegetables. He didn't carefully select what he had to offer God. He just picked whatever he could to kind of go through the motions. He offered God the leftovers, thinking perhaps this would be good enough. You see, Cain just gathered some of the harvest, just something to go through the motion. Cain's heart wasn't into it. And Cain knew that he didn't bring the best to God. Cain's attitude was, I will come and make an offering, but I'll do it on my terms, not yours. The New Testament in Hebrews would remind us, it was by faith that Abel brought a more acceptable offering to God than Cain did. Abel's offering gave evidence that he was a righteous man, and God showed approval of his gifts. And Abel was long dead and still speaks to us as an example of faith. The prophet Amos in the Old Testament says, I hate your show and pretense, the hypocrisy of your religious festivals and solemn assemblies. I will not accept your burnt offerings and grain offerings. I won't even notice all your choice peace offerings. Away with your noisy hymns of praise. I will not listen to the music of your harps. Amos was calling the people to faithfulness, to be genuine in their worship, to truly worship God from their heart and with their mind and soul. That Amos' people couldn't just play church, but they came with a heart ready to worship God. When we worship God, do we do it on our terms or His terms? God suggests and says that there's a proper way to worship, and that is from the heart and a desire to truly serve selflessly. You see, God really does want our worship, but He wants it on voluntary terms to be truly a gift of who we are individually. There was a cheerful young girl with bouncy golden curls. She was almost 5 years of age, and she was with her mother at the checkout stand. She saw this circle of glistening white pearls in a pink box. Oh, Mommy, can I have them? Please, Mommy, please. Quickly, the mother checked the box, the little foil box, and looked back in the pleading blue eyes of the youngster. $1.95. That's almost $2. If you really want them, I think you'll have to do some extra chores, and you can save up the money to buy them for yourself. Your birthday's only a week away, and your grandmother will give you a crisp new dollar bill. As soon as Jenny got home, she emptied her penny bank and counted 1, 2, 17 shiny pennies. After dinner, she was more than willing to do her share of the chores, and she even went next door to see Mrs. McJames to see if she could pull dandelions for a dime. On her birthday, Grandma did indeed give Jenny a crisp new dollar bill. And at long last, she had enough money to buy those pearl necklace that she so desired. They made her feel so dressed up and grown up. She wore them every day to Sunday school and kindergarten and even to bed at night. The only time she took them off was when she went swimming or took her bubble bath. Mother had reminded her if she wore them then that it would turn her neck green. And Jenny had a loving dad, and every night when she was ready for bed, he would stop everything he did and he would go upstairs and read Jenny a story. One night as he finished the story, he asked Jenny, "Do you love me?" "Oh, yes, Daddy, you know I love you." "Then give me your pearls." "Oh, Daddy, not my pearls. But you can have my princess, the white horse from my collection, the one with a pink tail. Remember, Daddy, you gave it to me. She's my favorite." "That's okay, honey. Daddy loves you. Good night." And he kissed her. About a week later, after the story time, Jenny's daddy asked again, "Do you love me?" She said, "Oh, yes, Daddy." And he asked her, "Give me your pearls." "Oh, Daddy, not my pearls, but you can have my baby doll, the brand new one I got for my birthday. She's so beautiful, and you can have the yellow blanket that goes with it that matches her outfit." "That's okay. Sleep well," Daddy said. "God bless you." And he gave her a kiss good night. A few nights later, when Daddy came into the room to read the story, he found little Jenny sitting on her bed, her legs crossed, her sitting upright. As he came close, he noticed that her chin was trembling, and one silent tear rolled down her cheek. Her dad asked her, "What is it, Jenny? What's the matter?" Jenny didn't say anything. She just lifted her little hand up to her daddy. And when she opened it, there was her little pearl necklace. With a quiver in her voice, she finally said, "Here, Daddy, it's for you." With tears gathering in his own eyes, Jenny's kind daddy reached out with one hand to take the dime store necklace. And with the other hand, he'd reached into his pocket and pulled out a blue velvet case with a strand of genuine pearls. And he gave it to Jenny. You see, he had had that all the time. He was just waiting for her to give up her dime store pearls so he could give her a genuine treasure. You see, God has offered Jesus Christ, his firstborn, the very best that he had as a sacrifice for each of us, as a gift for each of us. And God is waiting for us to give our very best in worship and service of him. He really wants to bless us in our lives, not with pearls, but with the gift of life, eternal and spiritual blessings, to pour out his love upon us. He's offered us the gift of salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. You see, God is offering us the very best of the best. And we have an opportunity to share the best of who we are as individuals. Amen. I thank you all for being here this morning. Mark, I thank you for the wonderful job you've done this morning as well. God said to Moses, I want to bless my people. Tell Aaron and his sons, they were the priests. This is how I want you to bless them. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance towards you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.